Rowan, if we can turn to you, there's the roots of much more justice-oriented kind of moralities around debt in lots of different faith traditions. Joe mentioned some in his introduction, but obviously the Jewish scriptures called for times of Jubilee to free people from debt slavery. And obviously in Christianity, the gospel writers record Jesus is putting debt forgiveness at the centre of his prayer for a new world. Do you think the moral and ethical teachings of the Bible open up space for a redefinition of this dominant morality that we've heard from Andrew and Njoki about?
Well, thank you. And let me echo the thanks of the other speakers to everyone for coming today and for the organisers for putting this on. I think there certainly are resources of the kind you mention in the tradition. And one of the things I think of that's, to me, been most startling and is still most challenging is something that was said by William Tyndale, the translator of the Bible into English in the 16th century, who had a remarkably visionary, radical sense of what the reading of Scripture might do for British society at that point. And one of the things he says is that we have to remember that whatever we have that is superfluous, we owe to those who haven't got enough. Whatever we have that is superfluous, we actually owe to those who don't have enough. And that does exactly the reversal that's been talked about, making us rethink debt in terms of basic human obligation. But that's where I'd want to go back to the Hebrew scriptures and the concept of Jubilee that you mentioned. And it's been sort of dusted off and deepened in discussion in the last couple of decades in the ways we've heard. And essentially, it's a system of amnesty in cycles of 7 years and cycles of 7 times 7, 49 years. There is essentially a debt amnesty, and this is laid out in some detail in some of the books in Hebrew scripture, particularly in Leviticus. And since you may not all instantly have this at your fingertips, let me just pick out a couple of details from the discussion there, because I think there are at least four principles in the account of this in Leviticus, four principles which are of real substantive value in thinking these issues through today. First of all, the assumption is poverty is not going to disappear overnight in any society. That is, there are always going to be people in need. So, question is, what's your response going to be? You can and you are encouraged to lend to the poor. But, first principle, you don't seek profit from another's misery. You don't seek profit from another's misery. And that explains some of the other constraints that are put on the process of lending. Second principle is a very radical one indeed. The land, which is the source of economic wealth and security in that pre-modern society, the land doesn't belong to anybody. The land itself is on loan to you from God. It's not a possession. Therefore, you are all already indebted in some sense, and to treat the possession of land and property and disposable wealth as if it were absolute possession is to misunderstand the whole nature of your humanity in a world where you are dependent on what you haven't made. This is a world in which you are dependent on what you haven't made. You're always, in that sense, indebted to start with. And in Leviticus, God says very firmly, I own the land. That's to say, you are all having the use of the land for a period. And when you're trading what you think is property, what you're actually trading is use. Practice. The practice of wealth production. It's a habit. It's a human practice. It's not based on absolute ownership. Third principle is the fairly obvious one built into this cycle of amnesty, as I called it. There's always going to be a danger of what you might call a spiral of asymmetry. Sorry about the jargon. A spiral of asymmetry. That is, the gap between creditor and debtor widening and widening and widening. There is no particular reason why that should ever stop, unless you decide to stop it. So, says the passage in Leviticus, you'd better decide to stop it. Otherwise, that gap will grow wider and wider, the wealth of those who think they possess spirals upwards, and the dependence and penury of those in debt spirals downwards. So you have to make some very clear, intentional policies about how you limit that spiral. And the last of these four principles is an interesting one. It's a prohibition of unlimited collateral. Let me explain. You don't take as security against a debt something that somebody else needs for their survival. It's put very simply. You lend somebody money, they give you a pledge, a token, a promise that they will return it. But if somebody offers you their cloak overnight as security against a loan, don't take it. They're going to need it in the cold nights. And that very, very simple image, I think, sums up the principle. There is no unlimited collateral. You can't, in other words, manage your lending in such a way as to deprive the debtor of what is essential for their survival and their human dignity. So there are four rather interesting principles, I think, and I don't think they're just relevant to the Bronze Age in the Middle East. The very fundamental one, ownership is never absolute. We are all dependent in advance on what we didn't make and don't possess. We have to be very clear and intentional about confronting the risk of unlimited spinning apart of the rich and the poor. Because, of course, the lender is always in a position of power and in a position to intensify the dependence of the debtor through the patterns of interest. We don't profit, therefore, from the misery of another. And we don't, quite clearly, go out aggressively lending in order to maximize our own income. The basic premise of all this is that borrowing and lending are to do with the management of crisis, that is, when people need what they can't produce for themselves, and a generous society encourages others to supply it, not at total cost to themselves, but in an ordered, managed way. You don't, in other words, undertake lending simply in order to squeeze something out of the dependent and make them more dependent. And finally, you don't go into the business of lending with the habits and the assumptions of taking away what is essential for the life of another. Now, I think all of those have a lot to say about how debt has evolved internationally and domestically in recent years. And I would say that pretty well all of those principles that I've enunciated have been ignored and sidelined again and again in every possible way. Both internationally and domestically, a great deal of the debt problem, as I think we all know, as we've heard eloquently this morning, has to do with aggressive lending. That is, with the passionate urge to push money around so that it doesn't sit around not earning anything. Somebody's got to be borrowing. And if they're not, there's something wrong, and you better go out and make them borrow. So the watershed period of the 1970s, when a lot of our current debt problems really began to get underway, had to do, of course, with the need to move around unexpectedly large revenues connected with the oil situation at that point, and the aggressive lending pattern established itself as normative. But of course, it's not so very different from doorstep loan companies in our own society. And that's another story, but one which I feel rather strongly about. Last point, and that is to echo what's been said very clearly by my colleagues here, which is that it's no good talking about the morality of debt without talking about the nature of the creditor's responsibility. And I think that's what we've heard loud and clear from the platform this morning. What is the nature of the creditor's responsibility? What is ethical lending? What is ethical lending? We have so focused on the ethics of repaying debts, because it seems obvious, that we've ignored the fact that to lend is a decision, an intentional decision, which therefore has moral questions that can rightly be asked around it. What is ethical lending? And a great deal of what we've seen has not been ethical lending, whether it's in terms of the international system since 1970, or more recently, of course, in terms of subprime mortgages. And there are moments when I feel that if I were in Kenya, or Zambia, or Colombia, or wherever, I might take it rather hard to be lectured on the ethics of financial responsibility by a system that in the last 6 years or so has produced what it's produced in Europe and elsewhere. I might take it rather hard to be told that I needed to get an ethical approach to debt repayment by those who clearly have no notion of the ethics of lending. So what is the nature of the creditor's responsibility? I think that's a question which affects both the situation of sovereign debt internationally and, of course, all those issues which produced the financial crisis of the last few years in our own society. And that has to do not only with the ethics of pushing debt at people, which is the aggressive lending I've been talking about, but also the blindness which has been mentioned, the blindness on the part of some creditors to the social and moral effects of insisting on debt repayment at the cost not only of education and healthcare, the cost of spiraling food prices, but also the cost of good governance and functioning democracy. Because that's another vicious circle that we get into here, which really does need to be addressed. So I think, yes, there are plenty of resources in the Judeo-Christian tradition, but also in others. I've simply focused on that because it's where I stand. Plenty of resources for looking at what might constitute a really ethical practice of resource exchange, let's call it that, resource exchange, in ways that would limit the risk of what I called the spiral of asymmetry and the consequent degradation of the borrower at the expense of the creditor. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Rowan.